Okay, so today I'd like to welcome our ISR distinguished speaker, Professor Alex Orso. Alex and I, oh my gosh, this is killing me. Alex and I have known each other for, over 17 years. When he was coming in as a postdoc, and I was not yet even a PhD student. I had long hair, he had hair.
I had hair.
and since then, he's done a remarkable, had remarkable success. He's currently a full professor and an associate school chair for the School of Computer Science at Georgia Tech. He's a senior member of ACM and IEEE Computer Society. And he's been program chair for a bunch of the top conferences in our field, ISTA, ICST, FSE, and most recently, and perhaps most infamously, imposed the three-paper submission limit for ICSI.
People just love me for this.
He's on the editorial board for ACM TOSM. And he does research in all kinds of software engineering, reliability, security, testing, and debugging. We started doing research in debugging, many years ago. So I'm really interested to see how we agree and perhaps disagree on the divergence ever since.
All right. Okay, well, thank you for inviting me. Thank you, Jim, for the very nice introduction. Thank you, everybody, for being here. And as Jim said, today I'm going to try to kind of see what the status of the state of the art is in debugging and where the field is going, where I think it should go. And before I start, for people who don't know me, just a quick introduction. I mean, I got my PhD in Italy, and Jim said I moved to the U.S. in 2000. I was supposed to stay for a short period, and instead I stayed here for a long time. And as you can see, I had some hair when I moved here, that was a long time ago. And my area is software engineering, and in particular, I work on static dynamic program analysis, software testing, and security in the sense that, I feel like a lot of in the end, the vulnerabilities are just bugs. So you just need to use a slightly different kinds of techniques and kind of focus the techniques on a kind of different common cases, but you can really reuse a lot of the dynamic and static analysis approaches and testing approaches in the context of security. And I'm going to start with some motivation for the work. And I've been using this motivation for some time now, so I'm not going to pretend that this is real. But it's it is, of course, coming from a real example. So it's a situation that we all experienced in many cases. You're using your software. Actually, just last night when I was doing making a last pass on my slides, I ended up with this situation. And what happens when this this kind of thing happens on your computer? You click OK, and what you get is this sort of screen. It can be different for different operating systems, but basically, it's telling you that there's a bug report that is going to be sent to the developers, to the developer organization, and they're going to use it to hopefully fix your problem. And the dream about debugging is the fact that if you're a developer, instead of having this this kind of screen, you will get something where that will allow you to debug. So you will click this button, and magically the machine will go off, do some computation, and tell you, oh, this is where your bug is. Okay, and that's really the dream of automated debugging, fully automated debugging. And so what I'm trying to do today is kind of going through the past, so the history of debugging from the beginning of time. What's the current situation, so what's the present, and as I said, where I think that the future direction, what are good promising future directions for the area. So let me start with the past. This is, by the way, is a talk that was a kind of a general structure I prepared a few years ago when I was invited to give a talk at the debugging workshop, and then I kept evolving this over the years. So it started as a short history of debugging, now it's a not so short history of debugging because it's 5 years later plus, I also added some more background information. And I'd like to start with a question for everybody. So what do you think is the first reference to software error? So I'd like for you to tell me what is the year for the first reference to software errors. Anybody? Wild guesses?
1840.
And 1840, the software errors were mentioned by other virus notes on Charles Babbage's analytical engine. And the interesting fact is that, from 1843 to basically for the next 100 years, there were several uses of the term bug to indicate the defects in computer and software.
And then after that, there was the famous case of the real bug and the actual debugging process that happened to the group of Admiral Grace Hopper that were working on the Mark II computer at Harvard University. And there was a kind of malfunction. And what they found out is that there was a moth in the relays of the computer. So that was an actual bug. So the history, and this is the bug report, by the way, with the moth attached to it. And so what the history says is that, you know, that's the reason why they're called bugs. It's not true, because in the end it's it's just a nice story that we like to tell. So we keep it going because it's a nice story, but the term bug was being used before this. So after that, you know, they started the era of symbolic debugging, and the era of symbolic debugging started in 1962 with the FLIT, which was the full location by interpretive testing on the UNIVAC. And in more recent times, around 1986, GDB. So for people who developed in see how many people here have used GDB? Probably, you know, a lot of people who developed, you know, using the C code use GDB. Its evolution, which is, or, you know, an alternative version, which was DDD, which was something built on GDB, which you could also navigate dynamic data structures, very useful when you had to kind of debug that kind of code. And then, you know, multiple symbolic debuggers were built either on top of GDB or independently, but based on the same principles. Basically, you can put watch points, breakpoints, and pretty much nowadays, every IDE contains some form of more or less advanced symbolic debugger. So in the next part of the talk, I'm going to talk about the kind of more researchy approaches to debugging. And the way in which I'm going to do it is for each what I consider to be the main breakthroughs in the area of debugging, I'm going to provide first the intuition and then provide a quick intuitive explanation of how the techniques these techniques work. So the first breakthrough was the idea presented in 1981 of problem slicing. And the intuition there is that developers basically slice backwards when debugging. And I'll tell you in a minute what that means. The author of the paper, the guy who had the idea, was Mark Weiser. And this is I'm going to use this example to illustrate how this works. And by the way, I'm going to use these examples throughout as much as possible, so you'll have to look at only one piece of code. And this is a piece of code that, given three numbers, computes the middle value, so we'll return the middle value for these three numbers. And there's a bug here in which this should be m is equal to x, and instead you can imagine for a copy and paste error, this is m is equal to y. And notice that this is a notation that was added not only in your code, you wouldn't have the notation that says where the bug is, which will otherwise make debugging very, very easy for the automation as well. Okay, so we're going to use this example, and the way in which slicing works is that you will start from the manifestation of the problem. In this case, imagine that you provide a set of inputs and you get the wrong answer. Middle number is the wrong one. So you will start from here, and you will start basically reasoning in terms of okay, why is this value wrong? So you will start by looking at all the places where that value is defined. And in this case, this value can come from here, from here, from here, from here, or from here. And at that point, you will go basically by looking at iteratively on the reason why these statements, for example, are executed. So this is called the data dependency, so the fact that m was defined here and used there. And then there's the concept of control dependency. So why was this statement executed? Well, because this predicate was executed and was true. And so you will include this piece of code, and then you will continue in this way, basically computing the transitive closure of these relationships. And for this specific piece of code, this is what you will get in the end. So as you can see, the idea was very nice in the sense that, you know, that's again what developers will do, right? Because if you want to know what went wrong here, you will look at the computation. On the other hand, when you try to automate this and do it in a conservative way, you end up including most of the code in many cases. So the idea was nice, that a lot of research was generated after the idea was presented, and there are now many techniques that do different kinds of slicing, for example, by not considering all the dependencies, but in general, you know, didn't work too well for debugging. So after Weiser presented his idea, the next kind of contribution was from Correll and Lasky that defined the concept of dynamic slicing. So slicing takes into account that there is an execution. And Agrawal in 1993 presented the idea of using dynamic slicing for debugging. So let me tell you how that works. So now let me enrich the example slightly by providing also a set of inputs, which are, you know, test cases. So for each test case, it consists of the three inputs that will be provided to the program. And then for each test case, you have the information on whether it passes or fails. So in this case, one test case that passes. I also tell you coverage information. I give you coverage information. So this is telling you basically that this execution will cover the statements where there is a doctor. And I have 6 test cases, 5 of which pass and 1 of which fails. Okay, so this is the general setting. And if you do, and by the way, this is an example taken from one of Jim's paper, just you know to give credit to Jim for this. If you do dynamic slicing in this case, you will do the same thing that we were doing before with static slicing. So you will start from the manifestation of the problem, but then you will follow the dependencies, so the data and control dependencies, only by considering only the ones that were actually exercised in the execution. And the intuition here is that you know if I'm trying to debug a failing execution, there's no point in considering all the possible behaviors. I want to focus on all the behaviors that were actually exercised in the code. So in this case, this is what I will end up with in my dynamic slice. And as you can see, this is a much better situation than for the case of static slicing. But can you see what the problem is? So is it much better? It's much better because, you know, of course, I'm considering way less statements, right? But what is your baseline here? So if you're focusing on the trace, your baseline is the number of the statements that were actually executed. So without slicing, you will look at basically the set of statements that were executed, and any of those could be responsible. So even in the case of dynamic slicing, what you're saving is really just one statement. Otherwise, you have to look at pretty much the whole trace of execution. So yeah, it helps. It's better than static slicing, but still, it's got limitations because you don't save too much in terms of a kind of a more strawman kind of a approach to the problem of debugging. So an idea that built on this is Andy Coe's Y-Lang, which was basically what I would like to consider a sort of a dynamic slicing on steroids. So what Andrew did was to build a tool that given a manifestation of a problem, in this case, this is a drawing program, and the problem is the fact that this line should be blue and instead it's black, okay? So what you can do with the tool will be recording the whole failing execution, and then it will allow you to point at the problem where, at the point where the problem is. It will analyze the properties of the screen, and you will find out that, you know, for example, for this point, one of the properties is a color, another properties is a coordinates, and it will allow you to ask questions. Like for example, as a person doing debugging, it will allow you to ask, why is the color black? And if you select this question, it will go back into the code and show you the part of the code where the color was defined. And at that point, you could follow up with additional questions. Like for example, okay, why did this code execute? Or why was this value set in another part of the code? So basically what you're doing a dynamic slice step by step and driven by the developers. So they did an empirical evaluation of this approach, and they showed that it actually helps developers in practice. So developers were much faster in identifying problems using this tool than without this tool. And this, to me, I really like this approach because to me it's like a typical example of where you use an existing technique, dynamic slicing, that has been there for a number of years. And by building a kind of a nice tool around it and by make it more usable, you can get much more mileage out of that. So in a sense, a lesson, I guess, for the students is sometimes there are techniques that are already there, and it's just a matter of how you package them and how you make them available through tools to developers that can make the difference between the techniques working or not working. Next breakthrough was Delta debugging. And Delta debugging was proposed by Andreas Zellers. And in this case, the idea, the intuition is that it's all about differences. And what do I mean by that? So just to give you an idea, the title of the paper, the original paper on Delta debugging was, yesterday my program worked, today it does not. Why? And so the idea is that when you introduce a problem into your code, you have 2 versions of the program. One that worked and one that didn't work, that doesn't work anymore. And you want to try to figure out sort of automatically why that's the case. And so I'm going to give you, in this case, the description of how the techniques work in an intuitive manner. So imagine that this is your program today that doesn't work. So for example, you have a test case that fails. And this is the program from yesterday that worked. So what do? To make this automatically, you do some sort of binary search on your program. You take the program, you cut it in half, and you take half of the program from today and half of the program from yesterday. And this might sound weird, but there's actually easy ways in which you can do this. So yeah, you can either do by trial and error, by basically trying different combinations until something compiles, or you can do it in a little smarter way by taking into account the syntax of the program. So this is easily doable. And so you do this, you run the program, and if the program succeeds, what that means is that this part is not responsible for the problem. So you will just put this on the stack of kind of a good versions of the program, and then you will do the same thing here. So that's why it's kind of a binary search. So you will take half of this from yesterday, half of this from today. you will do the same thing. You will run it, imagine that it fails. And if it fails, that means that at this point, this part is responsible. So you do the same thing and you continue over and over until you get to the point in which you cannot go any further. So in which basically there's only one difference between the code that passes and the code that fails. And at that point, this is necessarily a failure cause. It's not necessarily a minimal one, so it can be a set of statements, because by the way the algorithm works, you know, you can find smaller differences that are the cause, but for sure we'll give you a kind of a one minimal chunk of code that is the one responsible for the failure. And the idea of delta debugging was extremely successful. So it was applied, in this case it's applied to the program, but then there are several instances it was applied to programs, inputs, states. People use it in all sorts of contexts for network configurations. How many people here use version control systems like Git, Subversion? I would imagine most people. Are you familiar with Bisect? So Bisect is basically an implementation of delta debugging for version control system, which automatically tries to look at all the different commits and identify which ones are the ones that are causing the problem. So it's inspired by delta debugging. So somebody was asking me about impact. You were asking me about impact of research in practice. So this is a case in which, you know, kind of research had an impact in practice, and actually it's you know, it's implemented in a system that most people use. Next big breakthrough in 2001 is the idea of statistical debugging. And here the intuition is that up to that point, people reason in terms of reason about debugging in terms of single executions. So basically what they were doing is, okay, since the starting point of debugging is a test execution that fails, I'll just look at whatever happens in that execution and try to figure out what the problem is. And so the very good idea here was the fact that you have more information than that. Because for example, you might have multiple test cases failing for the same reason. And you will have a number of test cases that are actually passing but running on the same program. So Tarantula was the first one, the first paper to apply this idea, and it's actually the work of Jim Jones, Mary Jean Harold, and John Stasko that was actually recognized with an ECM Research Award about 2 years ago, if I recall correctly, and rightly so. And because this was really a breakthrough in the area of debugging, because it was a very, very novel idea on how to look at the problem of debugging. And so just to give you an idea of how this works in terms of the technique, this is for Tarantula. You have the same program that we had before, with the same set of test cases and the same coverage. And what you will do, you will assign a suspiciousness value to each statement based on the set of test cases that you have. So in this case, the suspiciousness for each statement is proportional to the number of failing test cases executing that statement, and inversely proportional to the number of statements that are passing and traversing the statement, which is a very intuitive concept. So if you have a number of test cases, you look at how many failing test cases execute that statement, how many passing test cases execute that statement, and it is proportional, inversely proportional to the two. And the reason why you have the number of total failing test cases here at the denominator is because you want to give some sort of level of confidence, in the sense that if you have 1 out of 100 failing test cases traversing a statement, that's a kind of lower, kind of weaker signal than if you have 100 of 100 failing test cases traversing the same statement. So this kind of gives you the confidence. And in a sense that the specific formula doesn't matter as much, in the sense that as you will see, there's a number of variations, but it's the general idea that you can sort of try to assign this suspiciousness or this probability of the statement of being faulty, which is the really, really nice idea. So let's see how it will work if we apply to this code. So for example, if you compute the suspiciousness for this first statement, as you can see, you have 1 out of 1 failing test cases traversing the statement. You have 5 out of 5 passing test cases traversing the statement. So overall, you will get a 50% suspiciousness, which means that you basically, it's kind of middle of the road. It could be suspicious, it could be not, because for what you know, all the passing and all the failing test cases traverse the statement. On the other hand, if we look at the place where the bug is, you have 1 out of 1 test case traversing the statement and 1 out of 5 passing test cases traversing the statement. So this is suspiciousness in this case will be 0.8. And you can do the same for all the other statements. And of course, this is an example taken from Jean's paper. So of course, you know, the highest value is used to demonstrate the technique is the one for the faulty statement. But this, you know, turns out to be the case in many realistic settings in which the most suspicious statement is among the first one, among the top ones in the ranking. So at that point, if you have this information, how do you proceed? You basically start from the most suspicious, you examine the code, You try to see whether the bug is there or not. If it's not, it will continue to the next one, and so on, until you finally get the bug. And so the idea here is that if this is ranked high enough, then you will be able to find it in an easier way than if you had to just look at the code without any additional information. By the way, since especially since this is after lunch, if you guys have any questions or want to flag me down, or even during the talk, I'm perfectly fine making this interacting. It doesn't have to be something which you know I get to the end before getting the questions. So feel free to ask questions at any time. So after Tarantula, as I said, was very successful, and in fact, a lot of people built on that. One of the kind of most noteworthy pieces of work that got actually an ACM dissertation award was CBI, Cooperative Bug Isolation. And in this case, the idea of Tarantula, the idea of statistical debugging, was applied in a kind of broader sense. Jim and Mary Jean and John was mainly focusing on coverage. So CBI generalized that to the idea of predicates. So you have predicates in the code, like, for example, the fact that one value is always greater than another value, the fact that one branch was taken. And so you can actually be as general as possible. You will put in all of this into the statistical computation, so it will give you kind of a richer feedback. And in addition to that, it was done on deployed software. So it was done on software running on people's machines so that you could get more data, so the statistical analysis was richer. And after that, a plethora of approaches were presented. So OKI was one that was popular because the formula was shown to improve on the original one. And people just built on that. There was a time around, 2010, 2011, in which every conference was receiving at least 10, 15 submissions on alternative statistical for localization formulas that could improve the ranking of the statement. Slightly different approach. Casual inference, in which instead of just looking at statistical correlation, the analysis was trying to find causal correlation. And the main advantage is that you eliminate a lot of kind of spurious causes. The drawback is that the analysis is way more expensive. So one of the beauties of the original statistical debugging technique is the fact it's very cheap. So once you have coverage information, you can just run it, so you don't need a very sophisticated analysis. This was is more expensive and more complicated in practice. It could provide some advantages, but it's more expensive. And finally, kind of a related technique that was spun out of this idea of statistical debugging and ranking-based debugging is the idea of IR-based techniques. And how does this work? They work by basically treating a bug report as a query, and the software as a corpus of documents. So what you do, you use information retrieval techniques to see what are the documents, in this case the files, that are most closely related to the query, which is the bug report. And as you can see, for example, in this case, this is taken from a real bug report for Mozilla or Netscape. There are several terms that, for example, recur in this file, and therefore this file will be the one that will be reported as the most suspicious one. And there's results that show that this technique tend to work in the sense that they tend to identify the files that are more likely to contain a given bug for a bug report. And after this, as I said, many, many others presented tons of technique. Even nowadays, at every conference, there's at least one paper on statistical for localization. So again, kudos to Jim for this work. And just to give you an idea of how much people worked on debugging, these are additional techniques that I didn't touch upon. So people really worked and spent a lot of time. Debugging is a very expensive activity, so people really spent a lot of time developing alternative techniques for debugging. And this is not even a comprehensive list, so there's really tons of work there. So with all this research, with all this work, what is the current situation? Can we actually debug at the push of a button? So do we have the technology? Maybe it's not still state of the practice, but we have the technology and we can use it. So if we look at especially at automated debugging, so rank-based automated debugging techniques, and we look at the model, so can we really take a piece of code, pass it to our machine, the machine will produce a ranked list of statements and give it to the developer, and the developer go and check out these places and find easily the bug by going through the list and marking statements that are as good or as faulty when he gets to the point or she gets to the point where the bug is. Okay, so what is the status? Are we there yet? there were studies, you know, some of these performed by Jim, some of these performed by other researchers that show that, you know, these techniques actually work in practice, in the sense that if you take a piece of code, you can actually run through that automatically through these techniques, and you can get a ranking in which the bug is in the vast majority of the cases among the, you know, let's say the first 5 or 10% of the code. And so there's it says there's some success stories.
Think of this biggest question.
I think it might be the connection with the. It seems like every time you move, it, you like the connection with the box.
Oh. Thank you.
Let's see, I can move it here. This might be better. And so basically, there's results that show that these techniques actually work in practice. But when we started looking into those more, because we were thinking, okay, at this point, these techniques have been out for 10 years. Do they really work? Are they really applicable in practice? We realized that they were based on sort of a set of relatively strong assumptions. And in particular, there's two assumptions that I would like to mention. So the first one is that programmers exhibit perfect bug understanding. So these techniques are based on the idea that if you present a ranked list of statements, developers will be able to go through a list of statements, look at the statement, and immediately, almost immediately, tell you whether the statement is buggy or not. And to kind of express this concept, I like to use this this picture. So if I show you this picture, right, and I ask you whether you see a bug here, it's gonna be sure if you focus and then you concentrate, you'll see it. But I mean, it's not that obvious. And the previous version of this talk, actually, somebody pointed out that that's really a reptile. It's not really a bug, so this is not correct. So here's another one. So you can look at this one and see whether, you know, how easy it is to spot this one, and even better, this one, in which, you know, the bug is really kind of hidden in the on the leaf. So the basic point here is that it's not easy to decide whether a statement is faulty or not just by looking at it. You need context. You need to look possibly at partial executions. So that's that is a problematic assumption in a sense, because it might invalidate the effectiveness of the technique. Second assumption is that if you produce a ranked list of statements and you give it to developers, the developers will go through the list one at a time and basically keep checking the code until they find the bug. And this is very good for comparison, in the sense that if I need to compare my technique with your technique, and I show you that in my technique the bug is in position 30, and in your technique the bug is in position 37, I beat you. So the technique is better. And in fact, that's what people did basically for a number of years. They were presenting these new formulas that we were tweaking the original one, and show you that you were gaining 1, 2, 3%. But our point was that are those kind of gains even relevant? So does it really matter? Will people fall, you know, operate in this way? And so the general question was, what do we know about the effectiveness of this technique? Interesting how it jumped around. And so what do we know? And that's what we decided to do, to study in 5 years ago or so. We decided to perform a study to see whether automated debugging techniques are actually helping programmers. And then we had a follow-up study a couple of years ago in which we were looking at IR-based for localization technique with the same spirit. So I'm going to try to give you the sense of our findings in these studies. So the first thing we did was, let's first look at what people did. So we look at the studies on tools. We look at the human studies. So in the end, for all this work on debugging, which is supposed to help developers, you should really study how developers use it after you introduce the initial idea. And when we look at the literature, and so we looked at, you know, 50 years of research in automated debugging, going from, you know, symbolic debugging to statistical debugging, we found out that, you know, that the scale was really tipped on this side. There were a lot of analytical studies, but very few, actually, it's really a handful of studies using real users, so using real developers and assessing how the technique worked for these developers. And so we decided to basically do an additional study and try to address this shortcoming of the literature. So what we did was to start from the hypothesis that if we were to build into a commonly used ID, in this case Eclipse, one of those statistical for localization techniques, and we were to give it to developers, what will happen? So in particular, we asked a set of research questions. First of all, do programmers who use automatic debugging tools locate the bugs faster than programmers who do not use such tools? Of course, if my tools is useful, I would expect developers to be more efficient in locating bugs than if they don't use it.
Is the effectiveness of debugging with automated tools affected by the faulty statements rank? Since there is such a big focus on the ranking of these statements in the for localization in the results of the analysis, does it really matter? Does the ranking matter? Does saving 5% really help the developers? And research question number three, do developers navigate a list of statements ranked by suspiciousness in the order provided? So this was one of the assumptions that we thought was a strong assumption. And so we wanted to check what is the behavior of developers when they receive this list. And finally, does perfect bug understanding exist? So how long does it take for developers when they look at the line of code, what the bug is, to actually decide whether the code is buggy or not? And we performed two user studies. One on spectra-based for localization techniques, one on IR-based for localization techniques. In the interest of time, I'm just going to talk about the first one. So this is the experimental protocol. So what we did, we selected 34 developers. And the caveat, with many user studies in academia, our developers are master students. So they're not really real developers. But we also conducted a survey among the students, and we found out that some of those had actually industrial experience, some of those had internship experience, and some of those only worked in classrooms. So we divided these participants into low, medium, and high expertise. So high expertise, people worked at least for 1 year in a company, medium expertise, at least one internship, and low expertise, no expertise whatsoever in a real company. The tools that we used was the rank-based tool. Basically, it's an Eclipse plugin that makes it very easy to access the information. It's just a ranked list of suspicious statements. You can click on each one of them, and it will bring you to the point in the code where the statement is, and you will be able to navigate at that point and use Eclipse in any normal way. And we were also logging all the actions that the developers were performing when using the tool, so which kind of files we're looking at, for how long, and so on. And the alternative is really any debugger. So the people were using Eclipse, and they could debug in any way they wanted. If they could print statements, they could use a symbolic debugger. It's just that they couldn't use our tool. They didn't have the tool that we built. In terms of a software subject, we used two subjects, around the 2,500 and 4,500 lines of code. One is Tetris, the other one is Nano XML. I'm pretty sure most of you are familiar with Tetris. Some of you might be familiar with NanoXML, which is an XML parser. And the Tetris bug consisted in the fact that if you rotated a square, which should have no effect, the square was actually changing position. So we consider this sort of an easy bug because it's very easy to understand. It's very easy to understand the logic of the game. So people should be able to get a very good intuition of what the problem might be. And the bug of NanoXML was instead a parsing bug. So if you were providing a suitably crafted input, an exception was being thrown. So the problem was crashing with an exception. And we consider this to be a harder problem because it's a parser, it's a more complex piece of software. It's not that straightforward to figure out what the problem is. You just have an exception, and you have to understand basically what is causing the exception. In terms of the tasks, the two tasks that were provided to the participants were discovering what the fault in Tetris is and how to fix it, discovering what the fault in NanoXML is and how to fix it. It was 30 minutes per task, and there was a questionnaire provided at the end in which we were trying to understand what was the experience of the developers with the tool and what they liked, what they didn't like, what they could have changed, and so on and so forth. What worked, what didn't work. The study was in two parts. In the first part, we had two groups of participants. Group A was getting the tool, was using the tool to debug the Tetris bug, and no tool to debug the NanoXML bug. And Group B was doing exactly the opposite. So we had no tool available to debug the Tetris bug, and the tool to debug the NanoXML bug. And in both cases, they were able to recreate test cases that allowed them to recreate the problem. So they could just rerun the program, investigate in other ways what the issue was. For the second part of the study, which was the one that we used to assess the importance of the ranking in the automated debugging, we basically divided and multiplied by five the existing ranking for the two bugs. So in this case, we lowered from 7 to 35 the position of the faulty statement in the rank, and in this case, we raised from 83 to 16 the rank of the statement. And the idea was that, you know, this group will be working with the original ranking, this group will be working with the lower and raised ranking, and we wanted to assess whether the performance was different in the two cases. So these are the study results, and so on this matrix, so for groups A, B, C, and D, Tetris, and Nano XML, and what I'm showing here, whether, you know, the use of the tool, the different ranking made any difference, and unfortunately, the general results, there was not significantly different. So for none of these cases, the fact of using the tool or the fact of using a different ranking was making any kind of statistically significant difference in the performance of the developers. And the only kind of saving grace, or the only kind of notable difference was that if we were to stratify the developers, the experience, the developers based on their experience for this part, for Tetris. So in this case, the expert developers performed much better with the tool than without the tool for Tetris. The reason why that happened, unfortunately, though, is for the wrong reasons, in a sense. Not because of the way the tool was working, but because of the way, by being expert, they were using the tool. And I'll tell you in a second what that means. So in terms of findings, so first of all, the question of do programmers who use automated debugging tools are faster in locating the bug than the ones that don't use it? The answer is yes, in case they're expert. And I say with caveats. So why? We basically looked at the questionnaires and we looked at the logs to figure out why the tool worked well for these developers. And the reason why it worked well was because they were not following the ranked statement. But what they were doing, they were making an hypothesis. They were saying, okay, this is a Tetris bug that has to do with the rotational squares. So I'm going to look for statements that are related to rotation. So they basically they went to the ranked list and they were focusing on the statements that were in a method called rotate or something along those lines. And then immediately, basically, or almost immediately, they were able to find the problem. So in a sense, search combined with the ranking worked extremely well for these developers, but just because they made an initial hypothesis in their mind. And for the other ones, does the statement rank affect the performance? The answer is no. So there was no significant difference. So whether the bug was in position 7 or 35 didn't make a difference. Whether it was in position 16 or 83 didn't make any difference in the performance. And do developers navigate a list of statements ranked by suspiciousness in the order provided? Again, the answer is no. So we looked at the logs, and basically what happened is that developers were going through 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 statements, and when they didn't find the bug at that point, they were basically giving up on the tool. So they were getting tired, annoyed at the false, what you can define as false positives, and they were just starting exploring and doing debugging in a different way. Does perfect bug understanding exist? And again, the answer is no. When we looked at the logs, we found out that even for the cases when people identified the bug, it was taking them an average of 10 minutes by the time they clicked on the line and the time in which they marked basically they had found the bug. So, and if you think about it, you know, 10 minutes is not a long time, but if you multiply it by, you know, the number of possible false positives, so if, for example, if the bug is in position 10, which is by all means, kind of a good ranking. If you think about a problem with 1 million lines of code, it will still mean almost 2 hours of work, most of which is spent investigating lines that are not problematic. So that's definitely something that turned out to be a limitation. So overall, what we found out is that that this somehow the statistical fault localization is a good starting point, but it doesn't work as initially conceived when you put it in the hands of the developers. And that's where kind of the next and sort of final part of the talk is going, which is future. So once that we have identified these findings, what should we do? So what are kind of good directions for future investigation? And there's several directions, of course. I'm going to focus on two that we actually investigated in my research group and my group and also in other groups. And the first one is what I call the feedback-based debugging, or humans debugging with humans in the loop. And here, one of my stronger convictions is the fact that this push for fully automating techniques is not necessarily a winning one, because of the fact that there's many, many things for which the human intelligence is unreplaceable. So what you want to do instead is really try to amplify rather than replace the human skills. And I think debugging techniques should really go in that direction. So what I'm going to describe now is an attempt that is actually ongoing in trying to define one of such techniques. And since we don't have too much time, I'm going to give you kind of the high-level intuition, and then I'm more than happy either during the social or during the question time to answer a question and provide more details. And there's a paper that describes it. So the idea here that, you know, that our, you know, our intuition in this case is the fact that if we look at rank-based techniques, right, so this idea that you can produce a ranked list of statements, give it to the developers, doesn't work because of the, it's too detached from the way in which people actually do debugging. So how do people do debugging? So the way in which people do debugging is by having a, you know, a set of, normally a failing test case, making some conjectures. So they look at the code, they look at the bug, and they based on their knowledge, they will decide that, well, you know, I think, for example, in the case of Tetris, the problem here is that there's something wrong with rotation. They will make their conjecture, then they will look at partial executions. For example, they will put some print statements. For example, they will run a subset of the code. They will put a breakpoint, and then they will run step by step a piece of the code. But basically, they will look at some partial execution, decide whether they identify the problem or not, and if not, they will refine their conjecture and continue in this process. So we wanted to support this process rather than replacing it. And one nice idea that we had was that statistical for localization can actually help in this process, because we can use, for example, this as we saw also in our results, a solid starting point. So this could be the conjecture. So you could use statistical for localization as an indication of where the problem might be. So you can replace the kind of the human part of the kind of the guessing game with statistical for localization. As for the second part, we figured out, okay, if you want to observe partial executions, a good way to do that, that provides a context and makes it intuitive for developers, is to have them look at, for example, method level executions. So if I can identify faulty statements, if I can identify which methods or which functions are the statements executed in the failing execution, I can build queries that are very high level and easy to understand, or at least in some cases, that tell the developer, okay, when I invoke this method with this input, this is the output that I get. Is that okay? So does it look okay to you? And the developers at that point can answer, yes, it's okay, or no, it's not. I mean, there's clearly a problem here, or I don't know. And at this point, what we do is that we feed that back into the full localization by creating this is kind of the current interface for this is kind of slightly kind of cartoonized. So we provide to the developers the input. In this case, this is the operation equals for complexes in the Apache Commons code. So you will see that there's it's basically saying, okay, your input is a real number. The real part of the number is NaN. The imaginary part is NaN, and the result, the other number is infinity and infinity, and the result is false. And you can decide whether this is correct or not, and then factor this into the process. And the way in which you factor this in is by creating what we call visual test cases. So every time you provide the method level query to the developers, and they mark it as faulty or not faulty, it's basically as if you were to provide a test case that runs only that method and has an oracle at the end that tells you whether the execution was successful or not. So we can use that transparently, basically, as an additional, and provide this as an additional test case or pseudo or virtual test case to the full localization, refine the results, and then continue this process. Okay, so does it make sense, the general idea? And that's what we call it, that's our technique that we call Swift. We presented a kind of preliminary version of the technique at HVC this year. It's called Iterative User-Driven for Localization. And just to give you a snapshot of what our results are, we studied 20 folds from three open source projects. In this case, the average ranking of a statistical for localization technique was 66.3, which means that, you know, basically on average, a developer will have to look at 65 statements before getting to the faulty one. And the average number of queries to get to the faulty method was 4.3. So in this case, again, it's preliminary because it's based on a synthetic, so it's not done with real developers, but it's based on using an oracle that will give you always the right answer when you ask about the method. But the average number of queries was considerably lower than the number of lines of code that you will have to look otherwise. And the other thing that we think is a win is the fact that, again, looking at the line of code without context is fairly complex, whereas looking at the code, at the method execution with a specific set of inputs and outputs and deciding whether that's successful or not is a more intuitive way to going about the problem. The second direction that I want to mention quickly before summarizing is the idea of formula-based debugging, also called the failure explanation. And the intuition here is that executions can be expressed as formulas, mathematical formulas that we can reason about. So we can get a kind of a more principled explanation of the bugs. And this is a set of techniques that I'm very excited about, because I think that, you know, despite the complexity of the techniques, it's a very powerful one. So imagine that the way in which they work in general is, imagine that you have an input, your execution, and then an assertion that fails. And this is your basically your failure, your crash, or, you know, any kind of failure, really. At this point, what you do, you build a formula for this execution in which you assert the inputs. So you state that the inputs are the ones provided to the actual execution. You assert the fact that the assertion is actually passing, which is not what happens in practice. And then you encode the semantics of the program as a formula, basically as a conjunction of conditions. And you can do it, if you're familiar with symbolic execution, you can do it through, for example, by building a path condition through the code. So you end up with this formula, and this formula can be for a particular trace, or it can be for the whole program, in case you use some sort of bounded representation of the semantics of the program. And what you do, this expresses the semantics of the program. This is an unsatisfiable formula. Why? Because the code is actually, the execution is actually failing for these inputs and for this assertion, and you're stating that the assertion is actually satisfied. So you have an unsatisfiable formula that says, basically, give me a solution for this that will make the program pass. And what you do then is that you use a max set solver. How many people here are familiar with the concept of max set solving? So the idea is that, you know, a set solver will give you a solution. A max set solver will give you kind of the maximal number of causes for which you can still compute a solution. So basically, a max set solver is allowed to drop some of the clauses until it finds a solution. So in this case, if you invoke your max set solver, you will get, for example, you know, your solution, which is this max set set. So the solver will tell you, if you just use an input A, B, and assertion, I can find a solution. I can find an assignment that is a solution for this formula. What that means is that if I skip basically condition C, which is my, you know, co-MSS, I can actually have this program pass. And how does that map in terms of debugging? So that maps by saying that since C is mappable to specific points in the code, you can identify these points as responsible for the failure. And you can actually demonstrate that this is responsible for the failure. This is actually a mathematical explanation of the failures. It will tell you that if you replace these parts of the computation in some angelic ways, doesn't tell you how, but it's, you know, here's some kind of angelic kind of way of fixing these parts of the code will work. So this, by definition, is a set of statements that represent the bug in the code. And then, of course, you know, you can have multiple sets, or you can have multiple different solutions, but that's a general idea. And it's very powerful because, again, it's demonstrable. It's not a heuristic. It really tells you these are the points in the code that make the execution fail. And in terms of, you know, the way that this works is bug assist was the first approach that was presented in this area, and the way it was you know, by Ruben Manjunder and one of his students. The way in which it works is by encoding as a formula the whole program, and it's actually a bounded version of the program. So as you can imagine, it's extremely expensive. So it works with very small pieces of code because the computation is extremely expensive. Error invariance is a kind of a variation of this approach that works on a single trace. Angelic debugging is also kind of based on this general idea. And recently, you know, with my student Wei Jin, we developed a technique that works in a similar way to bug assist, but it does, you know, it works on a single trace and on demand expands this trace until it gets to a solution. So it's got the same advantage of finding a solution for the whole program, but without analyzing the whole program. And as I said, you know, this is just, you know, a quick overview, and you know, if you look at some more details are explained there, I'm happy to talk about it. And now, you know, to summarize, so first of all, you know, we came a long way since the early days of debugging. So the general message is that, you know, from the point in which we were just doing kind of print statements, there's a number of techniques that have been developed. Some of those have been shown to be effective. We even got to the point in which we can do some limited form of program repair, and in some cases based on this kind of technique. So there's really a lot of work that's been done, and a lot of good work, and a lot of interesting results. But the point is that there's also still a long way to go. So there's still a lot of work that has to be done before we can really claim that we won sort of the debugging war. And in terms of where I think, you know, we should go next, some of these, you know, I already mentioned in the last part. So first of all, I think, you know, hybrid and semi-automated fault localization techniques are one possible direction. So this idea that instead of just doing a fully automated computation that gives you a ranked list, you want to try to include the developer the developer's intelligence into the process. Failure understanding and explanation. So you want to try to focus rather than on providing possible lines of code that are faulty, you want to try to provide an explanation why they're faulty. So for example, formula-based debugging will go in that direction because it will try to provide you something that is an explanation of the fault rather than just this is where the fault might be. And this was also coming from some of the questionnaires that we got for our study, because a lot of times the developers were frustrated by the fact that they had no idea of why something was being reported as faulty. And they basically wanted to know, so well, why is this faulty? Is that because of the value they got here? What is the context and so on? So you really, if you wanted to provide something that works for developers, you should focus on failure understanding and explanation. I think debugging of field failures, we've done some work in that area and other people did, is a very promising venue, mostly because of the fact that there's such a wealth of information nowadays. So all machines are really connected. There's enough power on the machines that you can actually run instrumented versions of the code, so collect information as that runs, and you can get way more leverage out of this information than just by focusing on test cases in-house. So if you can do that, while preserving privacy, that's a big win. And in fact, you know, most companies are actually doing this and they're collecting a lot of information from the field. Semi-automated repairs and workarounds. So again, both you know, techniques that will use some sort of automated or possibly you know user-driven approach to not only do localization but also do repair and workarounds. And if you're you know in the software engineering area, you can see that this is an extremely hot topic. So nowadays, there's a lot of groups that are working on this idea of automated program repair. So how you can take a program that fails and automatically build a version of the program that doesn't fail. And in terms of you know final takeaway messages, which is also true for other areas, not necessarily for debugging, one is I'll say it once more: don't pursue automation of all costs. I mean, I think there is this fascination with automation, which is great for some tasks, like you know, sure, compilation. You want to have an automated compiler. You don't want to have you know user input on the compilation process. But there's a lot of these kind of human-intensive activities for which I strongly believe that automation does not work. Full automation does not work, so you really need to find a way of enriching the computation with enriching the human reasoning and supporting the human reasoning rather than replacing it. Be careful and honest with your assumptions. So, for example, for the example of the statistical fault localization, it's perfectly fine if you have strong assumptions the first time you propose a piece of work, and it's perfectly fine if you have a new idea and you do that. But you know, 10 years. After the idea is out, you can no longer rely on assumptions that are not realistic. So you have to really be, first of all, careful. So be explicit about what your assumptions are, and then you also have to be kind of honest and try to reduce these assumptions as the technique becomes more mature. And something that I know I never thought I would have said, given the kind of work that I was doing before this: user studies. So in the end, if you work in software engineering, I believe that your goal, you know, what you're tasked to is to develop tools that can help developers. And if you want to show that your tools and your techniques help developers, well, you need to, you know, your techniques you need to implement into tools, and you have to put the tools in the hands of the developers. It's a painful process, so I think my most expensive paper was the one that I was referring, the first one with Chris Barney, because I'd never done a user study before, and it took us 2 semesters, or a year, whole year, just to do that one user study, because you know you have basically one shot, you get something wrong, you have to redo it, you have to gather the right number of people, it's very complex to get you know, authorization to do it, and so on. But on the other hand, it really pays off, because there's nothing, again, once the technique is mature, it's extremely informative to put it in the hands of the developers and see how it works, because you can be really an epiphany in terms of what you discover about what works and what doesn't work in your approach. And I think that's all I have. Well, I just wanted to kind of thank and acknowledge the people who contributed to this talk. And, in particular, the first time I prepared it, I was gathering input from a number of researchers in the area, so I just want to make sure that their names are up here. And with this, I'm done, and I'm, you know, if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to take them.
Examples were from procedural languages, imperative languages. Have there been any studies that assess the efficacy of these techniques in functional programming?
I'm not 100% positive, but I'm not aware of any study that does that. I don't know if, Jim, do you know of any study you also work in the area? I think people mostly focus on procedural languages for these kind of techniques. It would be interesting to see if it's a very different context.
Well, especially for your last technique, where you're building the formula
right.
of what goes on there. So you have smaller programs, more natural representation there. It might make a difference.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Yep.
So it's a question that I always wanted to ask somebody who was in this field for a very long time. Are there studies out there that actually have found how much people use debuggers in practice versus just printf?
I don't know if there's official. I'm sure there is something. There's some recent papers that is how developers debug code. I think it was published either this year or last year. I'd be happy to send you a reference. But besides that, I mean, I think folklore is that most people do print statements. No matter how sophisticated the tools become, it's every time I do a kind of informal service in companies or with students or at any level, most people like print statements.
Because I mean, that's my impression too, because I also develop a lot and I rarely use a debugger. It's only very rare circumstances that makes me use a debugger. So I'm wondering, you know, if we're just spending so much time kind of failing to actually recognize what is it that people really need.
So I think part of it is also the fact it's kind of laziness in the sense that we do what we're used to do. So same thing here, right? And I, at this point, I don't write too much code, but when I do it, in some cases, it's so convenient to just put, you know, a print statement there. But if you do it for long sessions, I found out that, you know, that's not very productive. So part of it, I think, is just we're set in our ways, and maybe it's a matter of educating kind of new generation. So it's not necessarily, it's like, you know, I'm blanking here, Apple's.
Swift Playground.
No. I mean, the Apple guy, the guy who passed away a couple of years ago.
Steve Jobs.
Thank you. Steve Jobs. You were playing charades. Steve Jobs was saying, you know, don't do user service because users don't know what they want. You have to put them, you know, put stuff in their hands, and they'll use it. And maybe it's a case like this in which if you were to build the right tools and you were to give it to developers, they will use them, even though now they're mostly set on their kind of old ways. So it's a good question. I think that the relevant question really to understand why that happens. Yep.
Any thoughts on how to catch semantic errors?
So in which sense? Because these are all semantic errors to some extent, right? So what do you have in mind exactly when you say semantic errors?
The ones which are more towards not giving the outcome which you really would want it. Otherwise, the program's running fine, and they don't appear that easily.
So I think, you know, for debugging, the general assumption is that you start from a failing test case. So what that will mean is that even if an error is a subtle one, you will have some sort of assertion that is failing because it checks exactly on that semantic property that is being violated. So the question is like, you know, the more open issue is how you actually identify these problems in the first place with tests. And that's a different kind of direction. So debugging starts from the idea that you know that there's a problem and you know how to make it happen.
The one which we normally call non-reproducible, infrequent, happens once.
So yeah, that's yet another assumption that saying about, you know, being honest with your assumptions. One assumption that is not even mentioned is the fact that you're talking about deterministic bugs in most cases when you talk about debugging and testing. So if they're non-deterministic, that's sort of you have to first find a way of making those deterministic. So for example, if it's concurrency related, you will use a special runtime system that is implemented that is kind of recording and reproducing the same scheduling at the time of failure. If it's something that happens once and it's not reproducible, then basically there's no way to debug in any kind of traditional way just because the problem might not even manifest itself.
Well, but has there been any thought in terms of maybe giving it some kind of rule-based input initially so that the expectation can be compared with in terms of outcomes? I'm asking, I don't know.
So. No, I'm trying to think whether there's I think that goes more in the realm of input generation. So there's a lot of research on trying to generate inputs that will identify these kind of problems. Like, for example, either problems that are hard to reproduce or hard to trigger because of the fact that they're related to concurrency, problems that are hard to reproduce because they're related to, for example, memory failures that will occur only under some specific configuration. So in that case, I don't know if it's rule-based is what you, this is exactly what you mean, but there's approaches that are based on symbolic analysis in which you model you need a model, so some a failure model for your code. If you can model that and if you can encode in some way what are the kind of failures that you're expecting, then you can try to generate inputs that will exercise those. Like, for example, by trying different interleavings, or for example, by triggering exceptions in the operating system that will not be triggered normally. So there's efforts in that area. And if you have anything specific in mind, I'll be happy to, any kind of specific kind of problem in mind, I'll be happy to discuss that further on offline, because people have been working on this kind of latent or hard to find bugs as well.
I mean, what has worked for me, I mean, talking about the last 35 years of experience, is number of coffees, the number of cokes. Besides that, you're stepping away. I mean, stepping away from a program long enough and to come back.
Oh yeah, yeah.
It's very difficult to do that.
So I guess that goes back to the fact what I was saying. And in a sense, debugging is a very human intensive activity, right? So you want to try to make it easier. So you want to try to maybe provide a technique where you don't have to take 10 coffee, but 5 coffees will be enough to find the bug. Maybe that's a goal that you want to pursue. Yep.
Are there any lessons from your research for software development? For example, you mentioned the formula-based method. Should developers put in formulas? Does that help?
So I think off the top of my head, I think that's related to something that one of the techniques that I think is most effective for debugging is the use of assertions. So which is a way of kind of putting formulas in your code. So if you do a good job putting assertions like precondition, postconditions, assertions, your debugging is done almost, because every time you violate one of those, you have an immediate indication of what is wrong in the code. So I'm a strong believer in that. The problem is that it's hard to convince people to do that, and there are some effort. I think at Microsoft as well, kind of the lightweight assertions and so on. If you could do that, you will address the problem from a very different perspective. But I'm convinced that you will have a very good solution. And then if you have that, you can also combine some of these techniques with this idea, because at that point you have a way richer set of information. But definitely. That's the best way to debug, a strong set of assertions and a strong set of properties specified in the code, invariants, for example, that will help a lot. Yep?
Do you have any other examples like formula-based debugging that could be used for programs that don't have test cases? Because a lot of people don't like to write test cases, but their program crashes and they still have to debug it, so.
So if the program crashes though, so what do you mean, how would you know that it crashes? So you need an execution, right? Even if you don't have a test case. So the point is that, again, you get to debugging when somebody's either submitting a bug report or you run the code and then you kind of make it crash in some way. So if you run it, that's a test case basically. So even if you don't like to write it, that's the facto test case that you can reproduce. The harder situation if you get a bug report, because at that point you don't have a test case, or you have somebody telling you your program failed in this way. And there is research there on how to go from a bug report to an execution that makes the program fail. And at that point, you can use a traditional debugging technique. So there is work in the area, and I'm more than happy to kind of point
they
you
have
to
stuff that can go from a stack trace to,
for example, a stack trace or a possibly some richer information, log information, that will give you kind of a set of breadcrumbs that you can follow to reproduce a bug. So there's actually a number of papers that try to address that problem. And it's the stack trace is a good way to do it. It's also somehow problematic in some cases, because the stack trace misses a lot of information, because the bug will be in one of the function is called and returned and is not even on the stack trace. But there is work that either uses richer models or try to explore also places that are not necessarily on the stack trace. So it's a fairly rich research area. And as I said, if you're interested, I'll be happy to give you references to some papers.
Thank you.
Okay, just one more question, and we'll take things downstairs, and you can continue asking questions.
Since there's two questions, maybe we can do two quick ones.
Okay.
Sorry to push. I shouldn't push the moderator.
A real quick question. You talked a lot about user studies, and you said user studies. User studies essentially require some kind of an interface that you can present to users.
Yeah.
It has to be usable.
Yeah.
So going forward, in terms of debugging, do you have any insight, any advice as to the kind of interfaces, how to present these things to users, new debugging?
Oh, I think that's an area of research on its own. And in fact, you know, when I was talking about Andy Coe's tool, that's a case, exactly a case in which the interface made all the difference. Because the technique, again, was a traditional technique. It's just the fact of breaking it down into steps and providing a nice interface that people could click on and navigate. So I think, I guess my answer is that that's research as well. So coming up with a good, I don't think there's a, this is the good that you should use for debugging. I think every technique